days as an economics 101 students, potential growth used to be shown very nicely in a very simple curve. But as simple as it is as difficult it is to measure. When it comes to the measurement, there are lots of gaps, ifs and buts. And so, but at the same time, this is something that we all in our policy making area deal with, try to get a feel for what it could be. Nobody can say this is the potential growth level for Bangladesh or for definitely. But we always work with some working approach, working estimates or projections or assumptions, whatever you call it, depending on your confidence that you have. So, and the literature on potential growth generally started with, you know, that from the business cycle analysis that Western countries used to face or is still facing. But in developing countries like Bangladesh, business cycle, I don't know, what is the business cycle for Bangladesh? We have been seeing steady, similar kind of growth for the last 15 years. So why is the cycle? How would you measure this gap between the turf and the peak? It's a difficult concept again. So it doesn't necessarily go with the origin of the theory of potential growth literature for many of the developing countries. Of course, there are countries which are commodity-based. They have a commodity cycle which follows their business cycle, which makes their business cycle. Industrial countries have their own. Energy-producing commodities, they have their own. And wheat or other commodity producers have their own kind of cycles and growth dynamics. But for Bangladesh, maybe also for India, which are reasonably non-commodity dependent economy, and also relatively or less volatile in terms of growth performance, the issue of potential growth has a different connotation. And we probably will be talking about that along with other issues in today's presentation. We have a very distinguished members of the panel. We have tonight Dr. Tareque, former finance secretary. He had been grappling with this issue, I'm sure, when he was the finance secretary, and kinds of budgets and the outlook for the budget. We have on my extreme left, the IMF representative in Bangladesh, Stella. On my immediate left is Professor Ismail Hossain. And extreme right is Dr. Biru Pakshapal. He was the former chief economist of Bangladesh Bank and a professor in US University. And he will be the trigger person. I hope his trigger will not kill any of us, but it will put the subject in its proper perspective. So, Biru, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ahsan Mansur, and also distinguished panelists. This is actually a project, and thank you, DGBIDS, Dr. K.S. Murshid, for undertaking this idea. Actually, there I would like to introduce also Dr. Manjur Hossain. And Rizwana here is, yeah. So this is a three-man project going on. So I am just presenting something on behalf of everyone. So potential growth, how is it different from actual growth? So if a boy is getting some kind of grade, say B plus, and mother says that you are supposed to get A, so that means potential is A, but not achieved. So that's the point. And now, why am I presenting this? Point is that, why do I need to know it? Its main necessity is policy making. Because to make our policy, if I know where I should have been and where am I performing, that is the gap. If the gap is big, then I have to redesign my policy. If I think that, okay, I'm above my potential, then actually I have to cool down. If I am below the potential, I have to actually stimulate my speech. So that's the main point. A roadmap, potential output. Potential growth is the derivative of potential output, because if I get output and then we just get the potential growth by getting the rate of change in a developing economy, not developed economy, where usually potential growth is supposed to be higher than actual in most developing economies. That is economists' belief. Motivation. Well, Bangladesh needs to grow to achieve some government aspirations. It's not only government's aspiration, every citizen's aspiration to be middle-income country, upper-middle-income country, and one day developed economy. Now I need to know my speed. How should I speed up or slow down or move slowly? It's just like a marathon. So in the marathon, if I am speeding too much, maybe I'll run out of fees and I cannot complete this long distance of marathon. So the motivation is in Bangladesh, since we have a pressure to stimulate our growth, to accelerate our growth, should we do it? To answer this question, we need to know potential growth. What is our actual capacity? It's not actual capacity that you are doing your best. No, not your best. Which is sustainable over time, peacefully sustainable. And the role in fiscal and monetary policy, also in long-term planning. Estimation issues. So I would expect your suggestion which direction we need to go ahead. So this is a picture. You are driving and you don't know the speed limit. So there could be two possibilities. You are exceeding your speed limit and you can get a ticket from the cop. Or other, on the other hand, if you are driving less than that, that is bad, because you cannot reach to your destination in an optimal time. So in both ways, if I'm driving in the countryside of US and if I don't know the speed limit, that's a confusion. That is what is going on, that gives the motivation. So I need to know my speed limit of the street, and then I can design what speed I should have. Potential growth provides us that very rate which is achievable by using factors of production, and that rate must be sustainable for the economy in the long run. That PG, potential growth, will ensure natural level of unemployment. So not that when unemployment, natural level of unemployment, the number I have given is equivalent, is applicable for a developed economy. Like in the US, we get Nehru potential, what is called natural level of unemployment, 5.5%. Sometimes it varies over time. If you have seen the paper of Ball and Mankiw, that's, but that unemployment rate may not be applicable, the unemployment rate we get from Bangladesh, because Bangladesh's unemployment rate looks even less than America's. I don't know, but there are different definitions they follow. That's why. But if we come up with a position that Bangladesh's natural unemployment rate is 8%, and if we can maintain that, and after maintaining that, if we get some kind of output, that is potential output. The potential growth will not create any inflationary or deflationary pressure. If it is economies above the potential growth, then it will create inflationary pressure. If it is below, deflationary. So that's the point. So at a situation, this is theoretical motivation though, because inflation has other factors to play in, like supply side, rainfall, howl, sudden flood. Methods. There are primarily two major categories to related to calculation. One is statistical, another is economic. Statistical methods are, to some extent, blind methods. In a sense that it gets the data and that it goes some kind of moving average, like HP filter. There are different techniques, Kalman filter, HP filter, so many things. However, on the other hand, the calculation comes from the supply side. If we take Cobb-Douglas production function as a model, and then we get capital, labor, and total factor productivity or technology. If we combine them, if we assign what is the share of capital and labor and get something, that is potential. potential output. So this is a just very basic what Dr. Ahsan Mansur was telling, that in our textbook we write. So this is economy, how the output is up and down. And there is a trend. Sometime we are in the peak, so economy is overheated. And when we are in the trough, economy is cool. So then we need to decide if we are above, then we need to take some policies, fiscal as well as monetary policies, to cool down the economy. So let us cool down. Like in the US recently, the US economy found that it is overheated. It has moved above the potential line. So they are trying to tighten monetary policy by raising interest rates. So that's what they do. Potential growth, why needed? I told already. With same reason, the driver needs to know the speed limit decided by the engineers. Because the engineers make the roads and they know the turns and twists, which speed will be affordable, thus in the long run, and safe. At the same time, you can reach your destination at an at an optimal time. There are mainly three areas where it is needed. Long-term planning, so just like five-year plan. Here is Dr. Shamsul Alam. He is from the planning, so he knows that we need to know potential output, fiscal budgeting, and monetary policy formulation. Five-year planning needs to know potential growth before designing strategies. Growth target in the budget should be grounded on potential output. So something we are doing and we are not achieving, that happened in the past, is not desirable. I need to know what is my potential. Right now, yes, I see the budget is in a big confusion. Few days ago, I heard from top officials of the government that our growth is going to be 7.5%, and suddenly it's revised. Next, what should be our next growth? Should it be 7.4, 7.5, or 7.3? That is something we, before doing that, we need to know our potential. What is our actual capacity as the speed we are running? The central bank needs to know whether the economy is overheated or below the potential before tightening or loosening. Also, we need to know what we have learned from our previous session, that the economy, Dr. Hossain Zillur Rahman told that there is no chance for acceleration. Growth is gradually, so trend of growth. So if you, we can have like a type of output path. A type of output path is growth acceleration. This is output path. So I am taking the growth rate on top of that. So growth is gradually accelerating. B type path is just theoretically possible. Usually the country doesn't grow that, but it's a constant growth, like 7%, 7% for years. C type path is gradually cooling down from 7%, 6.9, 6.8, what World Bank projected for coming 2 years or 3 years. Global practices. All developed countries have different agencies to calculate potential growth. Not only one agency, like the central bank, also the government, Fed Reserve, CB, Congressional Budget Office, the NBER, they calculate potential growth. And apart from, these are the government agencies dedicated to present potential growth as a mandatory task. On top of that, academics do a lot of job on potential growth. Or any kind of, even the Phillips curve estimation, you need to know potential growth. European Commission conducts regular studies on potential growth, and it is part of their work. The practice is not that prevalent in developing economies. So far, it's not that much done. But their central banks usually try to estimate the figure. Usually, central bank sometimes think what policy you should take. Regional practice, like China, India calculate potential growth before policy making. India did not start from the beginning, particularly from in mid-60s, they tried to find their long-term planning, and then they started to get something on potential growth, but that is still mainly statistical, maybe using HP filter, or no, HP filter came later, some kind of moving average or getting the trend. But now, of later, more sophistication came to the calculation. Research is on the rise on potential growth in other South Asian countries, including Bangladesh. what we see. One ADB study, it was not official, it was not downloadable. So somehow we collected from their classified papers. They have attempted to know potential growth. Here, this is as a pioneering attempt. The work is appreciable, but it has a number of shortcomings. However, this session is not designed to discuss on that particular paper. We have a lot of references, but that is a point of reference we want to see. One of them is that our objective is not only just calculate potential growth. Our objective is to see the horizon of coming 5 years, 7 years, 8 years down the road, because that is the time when we need to decide the policy. So it is something more than that. Based on a strong and robust model, we want to see coming 5 years or 10 years, the potential growth. Based on that, you need to design your investment policy. You need to design your annual policies. And also, 8 5-year plan also. We have some target of 2030 sustainable growth. Potential growth rates are almost similar to the actual figures. The ADB study. The potential growth we got there is, if actual growth is 6.9, it is 6.8 seems. So it does not have any prediction or future horizon. Well, this is some kind of hypothetical story, because if you want to make a film, you need to have some plot in your mind. So the plot in our mind is that if you see the red line, this is our actual growth. The red line we see, it is HP filter. So it is some kind of statistically accepted potential growth figure. However, as I told, the statistical method has shortcomings because it cannot see anything other than the data. But our process will be, of course, HP filter, Kalman filter, all other filters. On top of that, let us go through this model of capital. What is our capital stock? How is it evolving over time? What is our labor supply? Labor supply is employment plus how many hours they are working, so multiplied by that. That is our labor supply. And we will do two kinds of calculation, probably formal labor supply, what is in statistics. So we have huge informal sector, so part of that, if that can be tapped, what would be capital and labor. On top of that, technology. Technology can affect both labor and capital, so we will not be biased that it is only labor augmenting or capital augmenting. So if we do that, probably if we get the green line, so green line is not devised, something like that we hope to get, maybe below. If it is below, no problem, it is an educated information, so we can decide on that. But we believe that since we have huge informal sector, capital is not at its modernized state. If you look at the buses in our streets, you see, 35 years ago we saw the muritin, still these are muritins. But in many ways, the capital accumulation, quality of capital and technology, which can be brought just the next day. Sometime your capital and labor cannot be improved overnight because it needs education, higher education skill. But technology can come to your country even overnight. So that is how, if we assemble all these factors, we hope to see some kind of higher potential growth for Bangladesh. Issues and challenges, data paucity. Of course, our labor data is, well, we don't have any what is called NARO or natural rate of unemployment. In Bangladesh, there is no data on natural rate of unemployment. Because if we take the data from BBS, our unemployment rate is 4.5. It is just equivalent to American 4.5, surprising, but they have different definition. On the other hand, technology and total factor productivity, this is a big issue. That is why it is to some extent arduous job. Data on labor supply in an economy is in a high informal, I told. Unemployment rates are not comparable. What we get from US, because recently what US has decided, their potential output is above the normal. No, their actual output is above the potential. They just went to their unemployment rate straight, because that is highly dependable BLS data. But that is not something we can do instantly. Making total factor productivity an exogenous variable instead of endogenous variable, just it will be decided independently. capital stock independent, labor supply independent. Now, if I make total factor productivity is the residual of this, then it is some kind of self-fulfilling prophecy. So it will not, it will give me potential growth is closer to the actual growth. So that is not what we want to do. We want our biggest challenge is to make total factor productivity by calculating what are the productivity factors, totally exogenous variable by proxying other things. So I need your suggestion in this on that front. Determining capital stock and depreciation is also an issue, because usually standard economies, they have some standard rate of depreciation. In our country, it is 5%, 6%, 10%. What are the shocks? So it is hard to determine on average. Your suggestion to the trigger discussion and direction, data, and usefulness. So that's all my trigger presentation. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you. Our former chief economist has really opened the box. Now the issue is that how you put it together again and close the loop. So I will follow instruction given by BIDS, the order, and I would request Dr. Ismail Hossain to throw some more light or confusion on the subject. Feel free to add.
Dr. Mansur, panelists, and distinguished audience. Actually, I am a little bit confused in the presentation of Dr. Biru, who is an eminent economist and very respectable economist, and also my dear one. The concept of potential output, as he mentioned, came from developed economies, and it was to see the pressure on prices, how large pressure on prices. If the actual output is below potential output, there will be downward pressure on prices. If the actual output is above the potential output, then there will be upward pressure on prices. So in both cases, government has to intervene, the central bank or the treasury have to intervene to either pull down or promote the economy. Okay. Now, this is short-term macroeconomic management. This comes from short-term macroeconomic, also relevant to developing countries. But the thing that he presented later on, it belongs to long-term projection, long-term growth of the economy, and there is no output gap there. In the case of short-term macroeconomic management, the resources are given, the stock of capital, labor supply, technology, all these are given, and given these resources, the economy reaches a particular level of output. That is our potential output. Now, if we underutilize those resources, we will be below potential output. But in the case of long-term projection, when we project long-term growth for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, we have to make available resources. So resources are here flexible. As he mentioned that in order to achieve a particular rate of growth, we have to make certain reinvestment at a certain rate so that capital stock grows, which allow us to achieve that particular rate of growth. Given this background, actually, I was prepared to focus on the short-term economic management, which comes from this kind of concept of potential output or potential. Now, I come back to short-term economic management in the case of Bangladesh, and how we can benefit or cannot benefit from the idea of potential output or gap. As I mentioned that potential output is actually the best utilization of available resources or more efficient utilization of resources. And Dr. Mansur mentioned from our first year economics textbook that the production possibility frontier was nicely taught by our we are on the production possibility frontier. And we know that in developing countries, we are never on the production possibility frontier, below the production possibility frontier. Already we have an output gap. Now, how to remove this gap? That is the question. And that is not a short-term macroeconomic management question. It's a development question, growth question. Okay. In order to push our economy from underutilization of resources, the production possibility frontier, we have development policies, growth policies to move our economy to the level of output in developing economies. Secondly, the emergence of institutional economics. We know that developing economies are constrained by underutilization resources, but also by institutional constraints. Institutional constraints, probably you have come across some of them in your discussion on governance issue. If we are constrained by institutional barriers, growth is constrained by institutional barriers, then it is possible to raise growth rate by removing institutional barriers. If we remove institutional constraints, in many cases, particularly the cases where transaction costs are reduced, output increases because of reform, institutional reforms, then we move to the to near to the potential output level. In this situation, price will not rise. Price is likely to fall because of reduction of institutional. In this case, do we need a monetary policy to create an inflationary situation because prices are falling now? I think not, because it comes from removal of institutional barriers and the economy should automatically this price changes and output changes. But in the former case, we have to push our economy from the underutilization of resources to real growth level, output level. There we need policies which will bring underutilized resources into so that resources are fully utilized. And in that case, we have seen our in the development literature that inflationary pressures may generate, and developing economies are prone to this type of inflation, structural inflation. And in this case, and do we need monetary policy to contain structural inflation? Here is also a rich literature now, which gives us a threshold level of inflation, a level of inflation which actually maximizes growth. And below that level, inflation will not promote growth to the extent it should, and below above this level, inflation will actually hurt. There is no magic number. Different economies have found inflation. I think there is a Bangladesh bank study finds threshold level of inflation in Bangladesh 7 to 8%. In the Indian case, it has been found 4 to 5.5%. Okay, so it will vary from economy to economy. In terms of policy making, the central bank at the threshold level of inflation. Based on that, either it can take contractionary monetary policy or monetary policy. So this is the relevance of, I guess, idea of potential growth and use of monetary policy for dealing with this kind of problems or potentials in the economy. Now, whenever there is inflation, or there is boom. Okay, not experience boom as seen from the graph. So in that case, we also have fiscal policy, either to promote growth or to contain the economy when there is a boom. And which type of fiscal policy we should use, that will depend on the situation that we are in. But normally what we have seen from experience, that though there are two types of instruments, expenditure and taxation. Taxation is never rarely used. It is used in the developed economies either to raise taxes or down taxes, but in developing economies we do not have that privilege. So we control expenditure, either we raise expenditure to promote growth, and probably we contain inflation sometimes if there is very high rate of inflation. Dr. Ahsan, Mansur, who worked in the IMF, probably tries many, many times to contain expenditure when there is a situation like inflationary pressure in the economy, high inflationary pressure in the economy. And also seeing that in these cases, we do not have the privilege of containing transfer payments and subsidies as is done in the developed economies. Transfer payments are a very large proportion of budget in developed economies. Budget, and also the transfer payments that we make, it goes to the poor. Okay, so we do not want our poor to be poorer during any situation, so we do not use those types of instruments. Rather, we use discretionary fiscal policy. We raise certain types of public expenditure or contain certain types. This is the type of use of monetary and fiscal policy dealing with the type. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ismail. You brought out the issue of demand management, and that's important because sometimes countries do adapt demand management policies to contain inflationary pressures or balance of payment pressures, and while knowing fully, they're not operating at the commercial possibility frontier, nowhere near. So these are structural impediments that causes the economy to operate well below their potential level. And Bangladesh is probably one of those. There are lots of the structural impediments, like the one you mentioned, an institution. A whole range of institutions is, which is not going to go away tomorrow or there. It's a long, drawn process. So, but even within that, we have to operate and we have to manage our economy, and we have to operate in the second best approach perhaps. So I know that this is the task of the Ministry of Finance. Dr. Tareque has been doing it on behalf of the Finance Minister. He can share his thoughts as a practitioner in that.
Thank you, distinguished guests. Actually, I read economics almost 40 years back, and I left finance division almost 6 years back. So neither way I am relevant to talk on these topics, but Biru, I think he's quite insisting that I should be here. And I must thank BIDS and Biru and his team to present this trigger. I remain to consider three areas. First, concepts, as I still can remember, a potential GDP. Second, the data. And third, the policy issues that is still I can remember. Potential GDP, if I am not wrong, is a concept that is relevant only for developed countries where there is business cycles, ups and downs, so that they can see, as Professor Ismail Hossain very rightly and I think very eloquently described the policy relationship with the actual and potential gaps and how to is the potential and how to devise the policies. In the context of Bangladesh, I think we have to think why our GDP over year is something is increasing. It, in most of the cases, you know, we won't see that kind of path of GDP growth. Because as already pointed out by the chair and others, we are still inside production frontier somewhere. So the potential GDP is somewhere we don't know. Why? Because we don't know what our labor resources are. Because BBS doesn't know. Even I am, you know, I am going to ask Biru Paksha where he find the GDP series, because BBS doesn't have this GDP series. In Bangladesh, the main problem that, you know, I think you all who do research in different areas of economics faces, there is no real sector data. Biru, you won't be able to calculate the potential GDP without the data of labor sector data, and we don't have any series of labor data. So my basic point is, but still, as a dreamer, as an aspirant, we want to see Bangladesh is moving up and we want to move somewhere. We don't want to be 23rd, we don't want to be 11th, we want to be among the first 5 or 6 countries in, say, next 20 years. So what we should do as policymaker, as a researcher? I was none, I was a bureaucrat, but I was a dreamer and I still dream. And I think we have the potentials, and to see that, Biru, I think your team are a kind of a stay of the path. We need to find out the real aggregate production function of Bangladesh. If we can do that, then we can see that what is the total productive of factors of productions, what are the technological components, what are the unexplained components. And what are those unexplained components, whether that is governance, what is these institutions, what is that, whether that is technology. And so I think that will give you the policy agenda that planning commission want to see, finance division want to see. Even in case of Bangladesh, I think monetary policy is a short-term instrument. In short run, it can just, you know, trinker or a little bit growth. Over the long run, monetary policy doesn't have so much to say about growth or the direction of an economy. So it is the fiscal policies and to some extent trade policies that need to set the path which we want to grow. And I think I have already said what I want to say. At the end, I just want to say one thing, that in economics, you know, certain quotation I still remember. that prices are rising up every day, says my wife Berianda. I don't believe a word of it. It is a Russian propaganda. But one thing I still believe at my heart, that in economics and in economic development, at the core is a man, a rational man. At the core is the hundreds, thousands of men of this country. And the growth is coming from their efforts. They might not be at Dhaka, they might be all around the countries, but to move this country to the higher plane, we need to mobilize these people, and only then we will move to the higher production plan. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Tareque, for your insights. Now, let me request representative from the IMF, Stella, Kaendera, to maybe she can give us some international perspective.
Distinguished Chairman and colleagues, thank you for the opportunity to participate in this discussion today. Thank you very much, Dr. Biru, for a stimulating presentation and for my and to my fellow discussants for your insights on this important. I will not touch upon the other issues that have already been discussed. The data issue is critical. I share the sentiment of the and I will also not touch upon in sum, I can say it is hardly surprising that accurate estimates of potential growth have always been in high demand in both advanced and in developing countries. As noted in the presentation, long-term potential growth is not only the core objective of development policy, but is also a key anchor of economic stability. However, and as the keynote presentation notes, applying standard quantitative methods to estimate potential output in developing countries is subject to severe limitations. In particular, and that is the issue of data that has been discussed, poor data coverage and lack of high-frequency economic indicators make the use of standard techniques more difficult. You already mentioned that. Moreover, as economies like Bangladesh are often in the process of important structural changes, any model relying on a stable macro behavioral relationship can be a misleading guide for the future. So to assess the outlook for potential output growth, it may be beneficial to develop a framework that accounts for the dynamics of fundamental drivers of growth, as well as an analytical diagnostic of the constraints to growth. I think these two parts and this two-part strategy complement each other, with the model informing the analysis of growth impact. The breakdown of potential growth into contributions from factor accumulation and productivity will assist in informing the potential swings going forward. I don't know, Biru, if you agree to that, and the probable path of the main drivers and the focus of policies to harness potential growth. So given what has already been discussed before, I'll focus my remarks more on the policies that harness potential growth. As we all know, the last decade, and indeed over a decade, has been a remarkable period for this country with an average of over 6% growth, and some deem that output is already close to potential. This remarkable growth has raised the per capita income, the standard of living, improved social indicators, with the country now reaching middle income. The impressive growth performance has been a result of several favorable factors, including the rise of the garment sector and the expansion of international trade, consumption, investment, and improvements in productivity. However, the country is at an important crossroads. The outlook for growth and its potential is conditional on the country's ability to raise the rate of investment and its productivity, which are currently constrained by several structural impediments. Mitigating some of these hindering factors, for example, by closing the infrastructural gap would translate into significant boost to investment and a corresponding growth dividend. Raising the private sector investment rate is much needed, which in turn is constrained by the quality of infrastructure, lack of access to long-term financing, among other impediments to the business environment. The country ranks near the bottom globally in commercial access to electricity, roads, and rail, all requiring a significant increase in public investment. Overcoming these obstacles will be essential to generating the increase in private investment needed to raise the growth potential. Reliance on a narrow export market, which is in the current global environment, could also mean the external engine is slowing down unless the export sector moves up the value chain or diversifies into other products. Although the manufacturing and export sectors have probably been major beneficiaries of productivity gains in the past, relying exclusively on a garment-led growth model alone may be more challenging going forward. Countries such as China and Thailand, which have enjoyed long period of sustained export-led growth, are highly diversified in the products that they export. Vietnam has also been diversified. Of course, there are benefits and costs to both the diversification and globalization, but in the case of Bangladesh, several factors currently point toward increasing net benefits from export diversification. First, the uncertain global economic backdrop highlights the need for diversifying risks across both markets and products. Second, following years of rapid growth, the country is better positioned to start investing more in a wider range of sectors. But greater export diversification will be a function of the extent to which the country succeeds in sustaining investment. Overall growth potential will hinge on whether the country can successfully overcome its growth impediments in the coming years. Removing these constraints and related market failures will not only boost private sector investment, which is an important engine for growth in itself, but will also lead to discoveries of greater opportunities and areas of diversification, which will bring fresh productivity gains that will be the backbone for sustained growth. In sum, despite Bangladesh's strong record of growth in the past, the underlying fundamentals for sustained growth on many fronts can be significantly strengthened. Implementing structural reforms to improve infrastructure and promote investment and total factor productivity will therefore be necessary to ensure robust growth over the coming. We all know that investment needs are large and will require setting up intermediation of the countries and the utilized pool of savings over longer horizons, as well as addressing non-financial bottlenecks and financial stability risks. As commercial banks' ability to carry out this function will remain limited, policies to develop the country's capital market for financing long-term private investment would greatly improve future. An important impediment to modernizing the financial sector, and where fiscal policy comes in, arises from the increasing reliance of high-cost national savings certificates. Modernizing the tax system will be needed to boost the low-budget revenues and allow room for public investment and social spending to increase the levels consistent with government's growth ambitions without compromising fiscal. Strengthening public financial management is also critical. And finally, within this structural package, reforms to foster inclusive growth, including by upgrading human capital to aid job creation, will help in unleashing the country's growth.
Thank you. Very good to hear. Descriptions.
this is needed also. Well, let me now a little bit of summarization before back to Biru and open the floor. I think actually, like the search for immortality, we're searching for something which we'll never find in the context of Bangladesh, even our state of affairs. That's the bad news for Biru Paksha. So he has to deal with it. But that's the fact in my social growth level may not be found at the present. However, given that fact, how do you operate? We can do a better job by focusing on not the level, but the potential. Growth is much easier to perhaps put a hand on the level of outcome. That's much more driven. There are huge list of those. Go on pages after pages. Stella listed some of those of the. What did you do, for example, in preparing the 5-year plan, for 7-5-year plan or 6-5-year plan? Basically, we followed a practical approach, which is that input-driven goal. Underlying that is an incremental capital. That is much more simpler than we have some handle. And actually, if you look at the growth dynamics of Asian countries and including Bangladesh, drives it. Ultimately, how much input we are using in the production process, some degree of efficiency gain that's coming out in the TFF. And unfortunately, the TFF for Bangladesh has not been good either. So for the most countries in East Asia as well as Bangladesh, particularly in the initial stages, it was more and more input you add, capital and labor, investment and labor, you will get more out. That's the strategy that China, Vietnam, all other countries are following. And if you measure the Bangladesh context, it's also the similar story. Not that much of a difference. So we try to estimate the potential growth that we can achieve using higher level of those inputs and given the constraints on the institutional side and relaxing those over time on the hope that the government will improve governance, the market for investment will improve and there will be more private sector investment. So those are the policy imperatives which are built into that. That's how we try to bring some semblance of decency or methodological underpinning for our potential growth targets that we put in there. That being said, I think there's another side we should look at. That means, are we on a sustained path? That means, goods market or commodity market, some sort of equilibrium, not being overheated. Factory market, the labor market, not being overheated, which will be manifested through CPI being moderate, or wage pressures being moderate, and balance of payment in a sustainable situation. So macroeconomic management, if it is handled, that helps sustain that growth path for a longer period. We all know from experience of international experience, and the IMF is dealing with those, that economic crisis, once it happens, it sets back the process. This starts the whole process again. And that is the episode that we have seen in East Asia, that's the episode, repeatedly in Latin America, time and time. So, macro stability is important in sustaining that. Government is trying. That's my first thought. And maybe Biru can add more again, including thing, and then we can open the floor. Okay, so we can go to the audience, and the floor is open.
Thank you, Dr.
But they should have it.
Thank you very much for a very interesting discussion. And my name is Ahmed Ahsan. I'm a World Bank staff currently on leave visiting Bangladesh. So first of all, my profound agreement with some of the issues that have been discussed, especially raised by the panelists. And I think the comparison to us being inside the production possibility frontier, that's a very profound point. And that's a challenge faced by almost all developing countries. How do you improve the allocation of resources, move towards the frontier, and so on. I mean, two points I would raise is, first, the demand management side is probably will become more important in the future, given that the external markets are weakening, given that remittance flows are now slowing down. So there may be an issue of shortfalls of demand, so which may make demand management from the negative side more important. Like normally, typically in our countries, we worry more about overheating, we worry about inflation and so on. But I think there may come a period where the demand side will become important. And in the case of advanced middle-income countries or upper middle-income countries, we do use concepts of potential output and monetary and fiscal policy responses and so on. I mean, often the advice given to China, for instance, is that the economy is pretty much near the potential output and it's the stimulus measures that it's using is probably running out their course. So the demand management side from the lack of demand may become more relevant in the future. That's one point I just would like to raise. The other big difference with East Asian economies and Bangladesh is not just a matter of factor accumulation, but also a matter of structural transformation. Those are economies which have had massive structural changes by which economic activities have moved from lower productivity activities to higher productivity activities in manufacturing and services. That's the process in which Bangladesh still has to be, if you will, created. And that's something which perhaps needs to be brought out. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Sharmin Nilormi. I teach economics in Jahangirnagar University. Listening to Biruda's presentation and all other systems colleagues' deliberation, I would rather think if the title, you know, could be other way around. It can be the policy making and the influences on potential growth estimation. It can be like that. But it's always interesting to see what pathway and modeling a modeling is taking up, what assumptions the modeling is taking up as an not only as an academic exercise, but also it must have a policy relevance as well. But it is an evolving academic discourse, and it's always interesting to note that. I completely agree to all the esteemed colleagues' perceptions and deliberations. Just to add on that, for example, I would be interested rather what type of assumptions the potential growth estimation is taking up. For example, if we talk about food security, there can be a short-term management and there can be a long-term visionary management for food security. In our 7th 5-year plan, we have agriculture background paper and we have a whole section on agriculture. And in some sectoral cases, you can find that the learning from background document, it doesn't actually fit in those which we write in the actual body of the plan. So there are discrepancies, and we often don't try to learn from earlier experiences as well. For example, we had $6 billion in our pocket in Bangladesh Bank back in 2008. We had only 13% loss in almond production in November in 2007. We, in 2008 and 2009, we went to India, Thailand, Australia, and other rice exporting countries, and we couldn't buy one single metric ton of rice before May, the next harvesting period of Bodo. So that has huge impact, and we have learned that, you know, whether we should keep our domestic production on, or we will rely on, you know, food market in the foreign countries. So there are huge policy implications from those experiences. We had money, but we couldn't buy, and the India has kept on banning rice export from those on. So these are certain things. For example, the remittance has gone down. So now we have $30 billion in Bangladesh Bank. Okay, it's clear that there are reasons that oil price is going down in the Middle Eastern and we are having less remittance. But from the demand side, can we, you know, convert those remittances into capital stock? Do we have the, you know, proper environment to facilitate those, money to convert into capital stock? That's a huge question and policy ask, actually. So this kind of, whether we should, for example, labor market, should we concentrate only on the domestic market or should we explore foreign, you know, markets as well to export our labors, skilled and unskilled? If Middle Eastern countries are having saturated labor market, should we explore African markets or should we explore European agrarian markets? So those are the policy asks, and I think those can be, you know, blended into the potential growth models as critical assumptions, which we would like to see, how it's a development path that we are envisaging for. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Birubhakka. Actually, I am looking to points of challenges. First of all, data paucity. It is a big problem, as I perceive. GDP series, we don't have GDP series from 1972. It is a big task to do it. Can we suggest that BBS should take up initiative to make a GDP series from 1972 up till now? I think efforts can be taken. We have data series from 1990, one set of GDP, but we can't compare with the previous period. So I think Dr. Tareque has mentioned about it. So we don't have got the GDP series. So how can you make exercise? I think Dr. Tareque has pointed to that. Is it? Second, we are talking of the capital stock, but where is the natural resources? How can we calculate natural resources? And again, GDP also, environment adjusted GDP. Now the sustainable development program has come into force. So you have to calculate the environment adjusted GDP. So efforts must be done to calculate that also. Next, actually, unemployment. Unemployment actually in Bangladesh, it is unlike developed countries. It is near about 20 to 25% underemployed. It is not just open unemployment. Open unemployment, 5%, it is not the problem. Problem is the underemployment, huge underemployment. So if you calculate that, so the situation will be quite different. I have got one question to Dr. Ahsan Mansur. Suppose we have got the trade deficit to the extent of 5%. If you consider the high underemployment, can't we go for heightening our trade deficit 5% to 10% or more? What will be the consequence if we do that? And Dr. Ismail, I think I must address you. actually global situation has been changing. Now restricted globalism. In that respect, what should be our trade policy in order to address the domestic demand and the external demand situation, export orientation and import substitution types of things. So if we consider the restricted globalism, what should be our approach to address the potential growth?
Thank you. Faisal?
Thank you, Biruda, for Faisal Ahmed, Bangladesh Bank. Thank you, Biruda, for the presentation on a very important topic. When I kind of think about potential growth, it reminds me of love. It's hard to see it, but you can feel it. This is basically what Dr. Mansur was referring to in a developing country context. I think the best way to get a sense to is to look at the factor markets, and if you have price data, and if you have recent past, let's say last 4 or 5 years, you get in some sort of operational sense of where things are, whether it's hitting up. Two particular challenge for estimating it, relying on the data series, in addition to what Dr. Tareque had mentioned. One is that if you try to estimate capital stock using the investment, I don't know if we have representatives from BBS, but 30%, I mean, if you look at the investment of estimate, 30% of is based on, only 30% of it comes from direct survey, and that survey is more than 10 years old, right? So what we are capturing in the investment is a very small part, rest of it is imputed. So you and I, we could be both saying the same thing, but not opposing each other, but both could be right, because the margin of variance is so high. So that's number one. Number two is, if we take a longer view of estimating potential potential growth using the methods, the different tools we have, then we run into the escalator problem, right? Last 3 decades, growth have gone up. So whatever you fit, the escalator, it reaches the sky. Right? If you project an escalator, it will go up, keep going up. So those two limitations of data in the Bangladeshi context leaves us with the promising venue, what Dr. Mansur mentioned, looking at the subsector. So in the subsector, I think the manufacturing, we can get a decent handle. I think what we are facing there is the productivity is going up, but employment is not, right? If you look at the garment side. Service is it's a large part of our GDP, but it's also the fuzziest part. Even most advanced economy, if you look at the debate of the central banks of Bank of England and the Fed, they're grappling there, the service is a very large part. And they say that this is the fuzziest area of estimating. In Bangladesh, I think what I feel is that as we, the economists, we don't have sufficient appreciation how density plays a role in the service sector. For example, compared to other countries, opening up shops, far easier here, distribution of products, far easier because of the small density. So subsector, agriculture, service, and manufacturing would be the way to go in the Bangladeshi case. And by definition, we should have a very low degree of confidence and high degree of humility when we're talking about potential growth. And aspiration should not cloud us, neither should habitual pessimism. So I think the band would be sort of modest band in an operational band. Last point is on sharing how other countries are estimating. So if you look at the case of Vietnam, the latest East Asian story, if you look at the 2001 to 2013-14. Those of you who are interested in sort of understanding Vietnam's experience, there is a great document, Vietnam 2030 or 2035. There you can find this data. TFP growth has not contributed anything. Actually, it's slightly negative. It's labor and capital stock growth. So were the other East Asians. In our case, we should not have the bias to assume that we would be largely different. I mean, there are would be some difference, so it would be at our current phase, a lot of it will be the driven by the inputs. Thank you very much.
Anybody else? In that case, there's Ashik. Can you?
Sorry, this is Ashikur Rahman from PRI. I think more than potential growth, if we want to inform policy making, we need quarterly GDP estimates. I think that should be the policy agenda number one in Bangladesh. Because without that, we are just making policies without really understanding how it's affecting output. So that's number one. I think four issues that probably affects our potential growth, and I agree with Faisal Ahmed that we have to look at inputs and understand the prospective inputs that we are sitting on for the next 5-6 years. And if you see the current political regime and how the investment climate is changing, we can see that roughly over next 5-6 years, we're sitting on a potential investment of $55 billion. If you calculate the potential that China is promising and India is promising and Japan is promising. So now it's all about getting the job done and bringing these investments in a timely manner in the economy. So do we have that state capacity to internalize these investment prospects? The second issue is having the state capacity to push the tax over GDP ratio to 20% over the next 5-6 years. I think that has been an avenue for disappointment for last 5-6 years. We've been stuck at under 10% or 9%, and that is an area for priority. The third is the area of skill deficit. I feel that there's a lot of discussion on that avenue that we are sitting on a lot of human capital, but is that matching up to my investment needs? Do we have those skills there? And last is, I don't know, this is probably a hunch, an educated guess, but one thing affecting our stagnant private investment scenario is, and this is me just taking a guess, is credit concentration. I think this is what we don't know, that how much credit is concentrated in how many few businessmen. Because once few businessmen are sitting on a huge pool of credit, what we say is credit hangover, and then they're more interested in doing trading and making sure they sustain their repayment rates rather than taking up new investment. So as a former Bangladesh bank, you'll know better than me how much credit concentration we are suffering from. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we are running out of time. So, add anything?
Okay. I'm not in a position to defend because it's something I want your, and it is very beneficial. Maybe I won't be able to, we won't be able to, or our team won't be able to accommodate all of them. I'm not sure. Munzir, do you have anything to add? Or we'll work and we'll have a follow-up session. One thing is expectational. Some of you raised the question of institutions. Well, this is another area, lot to explore, lot to argue. Let us drop this. So in our model, we'll just assume this is as it is. Or if it is developing, it is developing at a steady rate. We will not assume. We will not make it a paper completely of institutional economics, just based on fundamental Cobb-Douglas production function from the supply side neoclassical model. Neil Ormi mentioned that assumptions are very important, of course, because that forms the model. but she also mentioned that policy making should come first. Well, that is a good credit to our paper. Means this is not a paper just to get some numbers. Numbers are important for policy making. So maybe we can think later about the topic or the caption or the title. What Faisal added is data. Of course, it is always an issue. Unemployment, these are not, but what he expecting that we might have some escalation, because if we are in some upward trend we are measuring, this is called the endpoint bias. This something we may get if we blindly follow statistical method that cannot read the situation, but probably we'll do that, but at the same time we'll compare, we'll base on something else. It is a totally independent structure we are building, and we are comparing with another building, which is the actual building. Despite all these things, I believe one case is that no GDP, of course, but there are some secondary sources. Sometimes it is filtered by World Bank. World Bank has some series. It is not the primary series. Sometimes IMF has some data like IFS statistics, IFC, we have to rely on that. We cannot take responsibility of making all data, but as long as the base year, if the data is consistent with base year, for example, if we want to start from, if we want to base on 1995 base year, probably we will not do kind of joining two or three base years. It will be consistently adjusted. But despite all these things, inflation is another thing. Some of you told that inflation in Bangladesh, and from my past experience at the central bank, inflation is a terrible thing in Bangladesh, because if it is heavily demand side driven, no problem. We would easily get the Phillips curve. That is not prevalent in Bangladesh. In most cases, as what Gordon added, supply side shocks are the dominant player in our inflation determination. And this threshold, Dr. Narayan mentioned, this threshold, we don't believe in these thresholds, because if you do threshold between 70s and 80s, you will get a different threshold. After that, you will get a different threshold. It's just like narrow is gradually, dynamically moving over time. So believing on those thresholds, as you mentioned that Bangladesh Bank has a study 7 to 8, probably it added all 70s and 80s. So that may be, so that was my suggestion. And I would say threshold can be different. So depending on that threshold and that getting the growth rate, something would be ad hoc probably. We'll look into that, and probably we can let you know the developments over time. But I really appreciate your interest in this, particularly when you all came knowingly here when the main panel is running over there. So I would appreciate, I'm not discussing all of them, but I'll take into account and try to do a good job so that BIDS as a center can give support, and I also need your support in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for patient hearing. Just to conclude with one last observation. We are a practitioner. Do our job. We may not have the perfect information, but policy making has to continue. If somebody asks me, what is the potential growth rate? I have to give an answer. And what would it will be? For example, I would probably say, think and say, okay, 8%. Why 8%? Perhaps if the government takes some right measures and so on, it can hit up to 8%. Why not 10%? Because I don't think the country has the institutions and other things to make. What is the government doesn't take measures? Probably 6% or below. Because we have some demographic dividend, we have some other things happening, some technological changes will happen no matter. So without government effort, we can perhaps get 5%. These are heuristic approaches to policy making, which will guide us in the absence of a more defined Sunday. Thank you.
Honorable guests, now we will have 15 minutes coffee break.